Hello again. Some persons merely wear cologne, but our guest today hails from there. A two-time Emmy Award winner for his performances, Colonel Wilhelm Klink in Hogan's Heroes, he is, of course, the very popular Werner Klepperer. And now, here's your man of the half hour, Skippy Lowe.
Werner Klepperer. Cologne, Germany.
Yeah.
Grew up there as a child.
Not at all. I think I spent 5 minutes there. I think we left Cologne in, I think I was a year and a half or two
really?
Years old. And we moved to a town that you know called Wiesbaden.
Ah.
And I spent 3 years of my childhood there. And then we moved on to Berlin.
To Berlin.
Yeah.
Arrived in America, California.
Arrived in California, of all places, yes, because my dad,
right.
who was a symphony and opera conductor, right. was made the head of the Los Angeles Philharmonic.
Uh-huh.
So we all moved from Europe to California, and my sister and I went to school here in California.
High school,
places.
College, or
High school, junior high school,
really?
Out in the West, not Westwood, but Sawtelle, the Uni High, University
uh-huh,
High.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
And I went to high school there, my sister went there, my son went there, uh-huh. my daughter went there.
Really?
Yeah.
Then Pasadena Playhouse.
Yes, Pasadena
How did that
Playhouse.
Happen? Tell me
well,
about.
What happened was I had a choice to make, go to college or go and do something about becoming
Music.
An actor. No, about becoming an
right.
actor. And I chose not to go to university, which my father did not particularly appreciate. But I said, look, I want to be an actor, and I don't find any sense in going to university for 4 years.
Uh-huh.
And they did have the Pasadena Playhouse around here at that time, and it was at its height.
Mm.
So I enrolled in the Pasadena Playhouse, and it was wonderful.
Some of the people attended the Pasadena Place.
Oh my
at
God!
That
yes,
that time.
A lot
Just
of
think
people.
About it. They were great.
Bob
great.
Preston.
Right.
His name was then Preston Meservey.
Uh-huh.
Laird Krieger.
Uh-huh.
Robert Rockwell. Do you
Ooh.
Remember the actor Robert Rockwell? Yes. I mean, this goes back.
Yes.
Louise Albritton was in my class.
Uh-huh.
Dana Andrews. A lot of people were around. Those were great days.
Uh-huh.
Great days. And for me, it was the best training because the Playhouse was the kind of school that did not stress academic work. It
right.
stressed get off your butt, go on the stage and do something.
And do something like Rada does.
And that's what it's all about.
Right,
you know?
Exactly.
Actors shouldn't study. They should get up and do.
Keep working at it.
Keep
that's
working
the only
at
do
it.
Do it. Right, right.
Face an audience.
What was your first play? Can you remember back then?
Yes.
You do?
My very first play was a one-act play, and this was at University High School.
Right.
I was in the drama class there.
Right.
And it was called Thank You, Doctor.
Thank you.
It was a ridiculous little comedy,
uh-huh.
and I played the doctor.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
And what was kind of fun, do you remember a character actor here in Hollywood named Edward Arnold?
Oh, the best.
Right.
Of course.
Well, his
Robert
son,
Stanwyck's movies.
His son was also in my class, and he wanted to be an actor,
uh-huh.
and we were double cast in this play. He
uh-huh.
played it one day, I uh-huh. played it the other day.
What happened to Werner's career after you did all this thing out of Pasadena Playhouse? Return Hollywood, New York, or what?
Nothing happened. I mean, I decided to go to New York and take a crack at
Broadway.
At becoming, not at Broadway, at just going to New York to take a crack at the whole theater life to see what would happen. And I went there and was there very briefly when I was drafted. You see, we'd all become American citizens.
Right.
And I was drafted into the war.
The military.
Absolutely, into the U.S. military. So uh-huh. I was off in 1942. I was off as a youngster to go become a soldier, American soldier.
So you did?
I did. And In a way, I was very lucky because I started out as an infantryman in a regular combat division, but I ended up being in special service. I don't know whether you remember that, but we had an actor here in America called Maurice Evans, very famous Shakespearean actor.
Of course.
He was made a major in the U.S. Army, sent to Hawaii, and he started a special service program.
He's the one who started it?
That's the one, and I got into that outfit. I auditioned for them, I got into it, and spent 2.5 years based in the Hawaiian Islands in the special service unit, and we had quite a few people in that unit. There was George Schaefer, the director, Howard Morris, if you can believe
Howard
this.
Morris.
Howie Morris was my first sergeant in that outfit.
Really?
Carl Reiner. We were all in the same outfit. And what we did is we were based at the University of Hawaii, and we produced these plays and sent them out into the Pacific for the soldiers. It's great training. Great training.
Hogan's.
Because what we did, I just want to tell you this quickly because it might interest the audience. We not only produced the plays, we built the sets, we traveled the show, we put up the sets, we took the sets down, traveled back to our headquarters. It was like having the
best. That's summer stock. That's good theater, good experience. You learn all the lighting, everything,
the
right?
The greatest training in the world.
So with that greatest training in the world, Werner Klimper, tell me, Hogan's Heroes.
Well, that comes much later.
I know, but good
that
God.
That comes much later.
Like, what happened to that? How did that all came
well,
about?
Well, at that point, you know, when Hogan's Heroes started in the 60s, 65, and I had sort of established myself out here, but not, when I say established, nobody could pronounce my name, but I was an actor who did in television. I did a lot of shows, you know, all kinds of shows. I was always a heavy and that sort of thing. And then suddenly this Hogan's Heroes thing came along. What happened was they called my agent and they said, we have this, we're doing this half hour show about a POW camp, and there is a POW commandant, and we want to see Klemperer about this, and I went. What they didn't tell us was that it was a comedy. Now I had a difficult time, you know, dealing with that because I couldn't imagine how they could do a World War II POW thing as a comedy. Well, the scripts were marvelous, and the rest is history. I tested with Bob Crane, and it worked out. The chemistry apparently was good.
Incredible.
And we were off and running, and it was a smash hit. Monocle was my idea.
Was that your idea?
Yeah, the riding crop was my idea,
was
too.
It?
Yes. I figured this guy, this colonel, is a real poop. You know what
but
I mean?
But sophisticated.
Sophisticated poop. Well-educated, but really a jerk. And he, very pompous. And I figured he would use a monocle because that would give him some kind of class. So it was a very typical Prussian thing that they did in Germany. And then I thought the riding crop would be good. It would be a threatening thing, and I used it like it was my security blanket, if you know what I mean. Yeah.
Robert Clary.
Robert Clary.
All these great people. Bob
Robert Crane. Clary, one of the most beautiful human beings in the world. He was one of the members of the cast, as you know.
Right.
Played Le Beau, the little Frenchman, and we became close friends and have been close friends ever since the show. Beautiful guy. Very intelligent, classy human being.
Bob Crane.
Bob Crane.
Terrible tragedy.
Bob Crane, very gregarious, outgoing, marvelous personality, fun person. He and I got along extremely well. We didn't become intimate friends by any means, but we were good acquaintances. We had great difficulties in agreeing politically. He was way to the right. I lean more to the left, so we had a little fun with that. But he was a nice human being, and it's a tragedy what happened. Of course it's a tragedy, and you know, we still don't know.
We
don't know the answer, and I suspect we'll never know the answer.
Really?
Yeah. One of those, you know, you sometimes get unsolved murders, and I think his is one.
Hogan's Heroes, still playing, still syndicating all over the place,
syndicated,
constantly.
Yes, the syndicated market in Hogan's today is one of the strongest in the business. They are all over the place. They are shown in all the major market,
right,
5 days a week, and in some markets and cities twice a day.
Uh-huh.
And it's interesting. Somebody told me the other day that, in fact, probably there are more viewers seeing Hogan's Heroes as you and I speak than there were in the 60s because of this giant syndicated market. This, you know, every station and 5 days a week.
And languages.
Yes, and you know what's interesting? We have a, we have built a new cult audience.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, we have people that were either not born then or were very little who are now seeing Hogan's and are really enjoying it. It's fascinating.
When you see it back, looking back today,
I enjoy it.
Did you expect it to be such a big success like it is today?
Well, you know, when we did the pilot, you know, when you do something in the theater, you know when it's good. And from the first day on, there was an atmosphere on that set, not only the actors, from the writers, from the director, and the crew, above all, they were all with it, and you felt, we got something here. And you know, when the show was shown to prospective buyers, there were two, the first time the show was shown to any of the buyers, they had General Foods and Philip Morris. Those two saw it for the first time. Those were the first two.
Right.
Bought it. Both of them bought it immediately.
Immediately. They knew.
Isn't that interesting?
Yeah. Hogan's Hero, you brought me a clip. I love this. You're in the office there. I want, with our wonderful man, Crane. Let's show this clip.
Okay, I don't know which one it is, but I'm
going to show you.
Okay.
Let's
fine.
Show this clip of Hogan's Hero.
Sorry, sir. I just heard from the Gestapo they are convinced of my innocence.
Well, congratulations. Now you can start breathing again.
They believe the explosives were an attempt on my life. Ah, we leaders, we're always in danger. All right, Hogan. That list from the box, I'll take it now.
Oh, yes, yes, that. This list, Colonel, is for sale.
How much?
Two extra slices of bread per day, all Red Cross packages delivered on time.
Granted.
And an extra shower every week for everybody in camp.
Granted.
My name? It's first. General Burkhalter, Colonel Müller, Admiral Metzger. Kronman was obviously going to contact all of us.
Sure, to get you into the conspiracy.
So much for that. Hogan, no one must ever know about this.
Yes, sir. Oh, by the way, could we have our first extra shower starting tomorrow?
What extra shower?
All requests previously granted are now denied.
I see. Colonel, what makes you so sure I didn't make a copy of that list?
A copy? Why, that would be silly. No one would believe a copy.
When you take that extra shower, just make sure your men don't use too much water.
Granted.
Wonderful. Every time I see that, I think you bring a smile to people. I don't know. Every time when you walk the streets, you live in New York.
Yes. Hello,
hey.
Colonel. How are you?
They say,
I
Colonel,
love it.
Do you really love it? Do you really?
I do. Listen, I'm proud. Let me tell you something. I'm proud of Hogan's Heroes. You know, there are so many colleagues of mine who do a show like I did, and they became well known for it, and they spend the rest of their life trying to put it down and forgetting it. I don't want to forget it.
So you don't have regrets what you have done in your career?
Absolutely not. You know, I did an acting role. This is about 8 years ago, at the Metropolitan Opera. There's a Mozart opera called The Abduction from the Seraglio, and there is a speaking role in it, a wonderful role.
Right.
And I did this production that was marvelous. And I walked into the Metropolitan Opera. Now, that's a whole different kind of feeling for an actor. And the first thing I get when I go on the stage, backstage, the whole crew comes by and says, salutes me, says, Colonel, welcome to the Met.
I love
loved it.
Get to the Met. Let's go. Narrate opera?
Yeah, well, I narrate a lot of pieces, with the symphony orchestra.
Tell me about this.
Well, there is a whole... Okay, your audience would know pieces like...
Right.
Carnival of the Animals, which is a well-known piece.
Right.
Peter and the Wolf.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
The Lincoln Portrait. These are pieces that people know.
Uh-huh.
I do those, plus others. There are all kinds of pieces for the spoken voice that are a little bit more complicated, where you have to read a score, be able to do that.
Right.
And I've had a wonderful time doing it. I do an average of 8 to 10 a season, and it's a wonderful thing to do
and
as an actor.
And also you conduct?
No. Well,
your father
I'm a frustrated conductor.
What are you saying, a frustrated conductor?
I have certain frustrations in that area, but I'm not a professional conductor at all.
You come from the music family.
Okay,
your father's a great conductor.
Right, right. And, he is. But I am just a frustrated conductor.
Are you doing, you're saying that word, frustrated. Is that the reason you're doing it? Because to satisfy your father, or you just, come on. I think you're doing it because you want to satisfy your
father. Let me tell you something. The way a lot of people misunderstand this, that I'm doing it every once in a while for a fundraiser. I will have the nerve to get up in front of an orchestra and wave my hands around, but I am not a conductor.
I've seen you.
Okay, but I just want to tell you that. But as far as the narrations are concerned, that for an actor is really a wonderful thing to do, because again, it puts you to where it's all at, which is with a live audience.
Uh-huh.
You're on a platform, you have 100 wonderful musicians behind you, and an audience in front of you, and you can't go wrong.
You certainly can't. And you were nominated for Cabaret.
Oh,
tell
yes.
Me about Cabaret. A few years ago was...
This is two seasons ago.
Two seasons?
We did, they did a revival, Hal Prince revived Cabaret. On Broadway with Joel.
My favorite show, Joel Gray.
It's a wonderful,
wonderful show.
And I was in it and played Herr Schulz, which is the... there are two couples in it, the young couple and the older couple. And I was lucky. I was nominated for a Tony, which I was
very proud of. You weren't lucky. You were just...
Well,
you're,
it was nice.
You know, you've been nominated many times.
And the show was a big hit. Uh-huh. We played a long time on Broadway, and then had a national tour prior to Broadway.
Uh-huh.
We did a national tour and then Broadway.
Lincoln Center, Sound of Music.
Lincoln Center, Sound of Music.
Oh.
That was my last hopping around on the stage, which was a year ago, and with Debbie Boone. It was a revival with Debbie Boone, and it certainly wasn't the first time I was in the show, but that was the last time. Yes.
Looking back, Werner, you've had a good time in your life, would you say?
Yes.
You've had?
Yes. I have to say that I guess I'm a lucky human being.
You're lucky?
I think so. God, or whoever that being is that runs things, has blessed me up until now with very good health, which I'm grateful for.
Right.
And as far as my career is concerned, it's been pretty good. It's been as good as I can expect.
Right.
I'm one of those, I must tell you something, frankly.
Right.
I'm one of those actors that treats my profession almost as a 9-to-5 job. I go from job to job. There is not a single job that I don't love. In other words, if I decide to do it, I give it all, and it's the best of all of them. And I intend to keep it that way. I don't have big plans, you know. Some actors will tell you they want to, they must play these three parts, they must do this as their final goal. I don't have any of that. I go from job to job.
Do you think, you believe in yourself that you have been successful?
I believe that I don't know. I really don't know how successful I am. And you know something?
Uh-huh.
We all have egos, but that's not the most important thing. As long as I can have a good time,
that's what
I feel great.
What's the greatest achievement that Werner Klimper has done? What is your greatest achievement?
I cannot answer that, because I don't think I have a greatest achievement. To me, as I said a little bit earlier, the greatest achievement is the achievement I'm at. Right now, my greatest achievement is talking to you. Now, you know that. Don't laugh at that.
No, I don't laugh at that.
But that means this is my job right now, that you and I relate to each other. Uh-huh. Therefore, it becomes the most important thing. Uh-huh. I feel that way in life, too, in my private life. Uh-huh. Whatever I do at the moment I'm doing has got to be the most important.
So Werner believes in faith?
I believe in faith, and I believe in a positive spirit, being positive about things in general.
So when you wake up in the morning...
When I wake up in the morning, the first thing I think of is, God damn it, I made it again.
That's good. I like that.
I think that's terrific.
That's good. I like that.
And now, not being the youngest person in the world anymore, those mornings mm-hmm. become very important.
Absolutely.
You say, look at it, I did it again.
You do a lot of charities and a lot of things for people. So you have a lot of compassion for people. I'm looking at that red.
Well, you know
right
what
now.
It is.
I do know.
I'm sure that a lot of people who watch your show by this time know what it is. Let me be very brief about this. And I don't want to bore the audience.
No.
I am happen to be a vice president of Actors Equity Association,
Absolutely.
Which is the union of the legitimate stage actors.
Right.
And we have an organization within the organization called Equity Fights AIDS. And what this represents, it represents the fact that AIDS, it is to remind people that AIDS is with us in a tremendous way that we must never forget how important and how devastating it is. In other words, it's an awareness symbol. And all over the profession now, we are passing these, they're wearing them everywhere. You will see that at the Oscars, they will be worn. Uh-huh. They were worn at the Tonys. Uh-huh. And I make it a point of wearing it every day uh-huh. because I really believe in it. What we do, Equity Fights AIDS, we raise incredible amounts of money.
Right.
And the money is used solely to help actors who are members of the union who are afflicted with AIDS. And what must be said is that people have to stop taking this thing as lightly as they do, because it isn't to be taken lightly. It can happen to everyone.
Yes.
Everyone.
Yes.
There is no such thing as it can't happen to me.
I understand.
It's a plague.
Yes. Musical conductor, I brought a clip. You showed me a clip. I love this clip. I want to show to my audience. You say you were having fun. Well, let the audience see how much fun you were having with this wonderful baton, conducting this wonderful... Where, I think this was in Boston?
No,
think,
it was Buffalo Philharmonic.
Buffalo?
Yes.
Let's hear it. Okay? Show this clip. Thank you.
Thank you.
just, your music is, how could you not say you're, I don't know, you're just wonderful.
Listen, conducting is a very difficult thing. People have no idea. And
did your father teach you? Did he?
Not at all.
No?
No. He didn't even know. He wasn't interested in my doing that at all, because that is something you either take up and take seriously or not.
Right,
and
I am
a total amateur, but I'm very musical. I know that.
Uh-huh.
And I know I can handle myself musically in certain ways, but I know my total limitation about that.
Tallulah Bankhead.
Tallulah Bankhead.
My favorite lady
Please,
on Broadway.
Tallulah Bankhead.
You worked with her.
In my life,
in your
life. One of the most important events. I spent a whole year with her. I was in a Broadway show of hers.
What was that called?
It was called Dear Charles. I had a wonderful, wonderful part. We played here in Los Angeles when we were on tour down at the Biltmore Theater.
Uh-huh.
And she became very, very close friend. As a matter of fact, she gave me my nickname. I have a nickname, and it's Klempy.
Klempy.
K-L-E-M-P-Y. Yeah, she gave me that name.
I like that.
She is one of those, you know, a lot of things have been written about Tallulah Bankhead.
Right.
A lot of things have been said about her, some not very nice. She was a great human being.
Mm-hmm.
Sure, she had faults, weaknesses, who doesn't? But she was a total pro. She was the first one in the theater, mm-hmm. the last one out of the theater. Uh-huh. She was a mensch.
They say Streisand's tough. She's got to be tough. You know why? Because she wants things done right.
Absolutely. I'm a great admirer of Barbara Streisand.
I believe people are professional.
I get so disgusted with people who put her down.
Yeah.
She, just look at her record, what she's done.
Prince of Thai. Oh, I walked out of that theater. I felt like a little boy.
Do you know what happens with people who are... You know what happens when people are really special and great?
What is it?
The people that surround them who are mediocre can't live with it. They can't cope with it. So what do? They run them down. It's a tragedy.
That's an interesting
It's a tragedy.
Is that what really... That's what
A lot of actors are called difficult because they believe in what's right for the work.
Right.
And people just can't take it. It's a shame.
Looking back, favorite. Any favorites you have in your career you've done? Anything?
No.
There's no
favorites? No, I told you. No.
Nope.
No favorites.
Nope.
Everything was good.
Book? How about a book? Writing a book?
No way.
Why?
I do not believe in it for myself.
You just said. You said no way.
No way. I do not believe in it for myself.
Really?
I really do not. No. I really don't.
Why?
If
Why
somebody really? Else, sometime after I'm gone, wants to do that, that's their business. I would never...
You've had
never,
an interesting life.
I have had an interesting life, but it's my life.
You're still married?
I am married, yes.
You're living in New York.
To the same lady for quite a while.
Really?
But I've had several marriages.
Uh-huh.
I have two children.
Uh-huh.
I have a daughter, Erica, who is a doctor, just became a doctor a year ago. She's
uh-huh.
out in San Francisco.
Uh-huh.
She's an intern, and I have a son who's right now in New York. And that's my life,
so
kiddo.
Werner,
that's
you're
it.
Having, so you're just having a good time in life. And what's new right now, exciting, coming up for
I'm
Werner?
Doing a bunch of concerts. I'm going to Brussels
uh-huh.
to work with, do a symphonic thing there, which are several concerts.
Right.
I'm going to Canada to do some concerts. There are concerts coming up. That's mainly it.
Uh-huh.
There is no play yet. However, there is some talk about something in New York for the next season.
What makes New York so exciting for actors?
Very simple for me to explain.
Please.
I was brought up in California, you know that.
Right.
So I know California intimately. I've loved it for a long time.